He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
In this modern physics series, we started out by covering the very basics of quantum mechanics, relativity, and particle physics. Then we returned to quantum mechanics with considerably more rigor, going in depth with the math and elucidating much more of the nuance. Now it's time to do the same thing with particle physics. These few initial tutorials on QED, QCD, and related topics were great for getting your feet wet with basic terminology and concepts, but now it's time to go deeper with particle physics, looking more closely at the math, and again uncovering more of the nuance than we were ready to describe before. The standard model of particle physics is arguably the most successful scientific theory ever developed. It predicted the existence and properties of many particles that were later discovered, including the W boson, Z boson, gluon, top quark, and charm quark. It is also responsible for predicting the Higgs mechanism and the Higgs boson, the most recent major particle discovery. On top of all these impressive predictions, perhaps the standard model's greatest accomplishment is its prediction of the value of the anomalous electron dipole moment. This is an intrinsic particle property describing charge distribution, and it deviates slightly from the originally expected value of 2. The standard model predicted this deviation to a precision of more than 1 part per billion, indicating that the electron is extremely well described by this model. However, humanity didn't even know about the existence of the electron until 1897, when J.J. Thomson found it using cathode ray tubes, like the ones found in old TVs. In barely more than 100 years, how did we go from a model that was developed from the first known subatomic particle to a complex and intricate theory describing all known types of matter and 3 fundamental forces? The history of the standard model was kickstarted by the flurry of particle discoveries in the early 20th century. Ernest Rutherford found protons in 1911. James Chadwick found neutrons in 1932. Then Carl Anderson found the first antimatter particle, the positron, in the same year. Within the next 2 decades, muons and pions were found, and particle accelerators started coming online around the world. With all these new discoveries, scientists realized they needed some way to organize and explain the particles. They decided that the best way to do this was to create a model that could serve as the standard for particle physics as the field evolved. Originally, an arrangement called the eightfold way was proposed. This took various particles, largely baryonic, meaning made of quarks, and placed them into geometrical patterns. It provided the first structure for particle physicists to follow and guided the field through the early 1960s. From the success of the eightfold way, it was eventually discovered that matter was made up of 3 types of basic building blocks, and with that, the standard model was born. It is currently believed that every particle in the model is an elementary particle, which means that it cannot be broken down into smaller parts. The first group of particles are quarks, of which there are 6 types: up, down, top, bottom, strange, and charm. These quarks make up protons and neutrons, so they make up most of the mass of visible matter in the universe. There are 3 generations of quarks. The most stable quarks are in the first generation. Those are the up and down quark. These are most of the quarks that we see in the universe today. The second generation contains the strange and charm quark, and the third generation contains the bottom and top quark. Quarks are all charged particles, and in the case of the proton and neutron, the charges of the up and down quarks inside them add together to yield the +1 charge of the proton and the net 0 charge of the neutron. Particles involving combinations of 3 quarks, like the proton and neutron, are called hadrons, but quarks can also be combined in pairs to form mesons. The next group of particles in the standard model are leptons. The most well-known lepton is the electron, which is a first-generation lepton. The electron has a charge of -1 and is present in chemical reactions, as it is one of the charged constituents of an atom or molecule. The heavier leptons are the muon and tau particles, which are very similar to electrons except for their masses, and these are second and third-generation leptons, respectively. The final type of lepton remains one of the more mysterious particles in the standard model. The neutrino is an extremely light and neutrally charged lepton with 3 flavors: the electron neutrino, the muon neutrino, and the tau neutrino. It was first discovered because of a range of energies produced from beta decay, a process whereby it was believed that a proton or neutron emitted a positron or electron. It was expected that by conservation of energy, these electrons and positrons would all be produced at the same energy, rather than a range. This either indicated that energy was not conserved, or that another particle was being emitted and not detected. With an extremely small mass and neutral charge, neutrinos were proposed as the undetected particle to solve the beta decay energy dilemma. According to the prediction of the standard model, the neutrino would have no mass. However, due to the observation of neutrino oscillations between different flavors as they propagate through space, it has been experimentally proven that the mass, although very small, is non-zero. There are also many ongoing experiments that are attempting to discover whether the neutrino is its own antiparticle, which would add to its intrigue. Both of these are examples of physics beyond the standard model, which we will discuss later. Another thing to note about the first two groups of particles in the standard model, the quarks and the leptons, is that they have half-integer spins. These therefore qualify as fermions. Since fermions are particles that can have spins of any half-integer value, like 1/2, 3/2, 5/2, and so forth. The final group of particles in the standard model are bosons, which have integer spins of 0, 1, 2, and so forth. These are the particles that mediate interactions between all the others in the model. This is why bosons are sometimes called force carrier particles. The strong force, which is modeled by quantum chromodynamics, or QCD, is mediated by the gluon. This pertains to interactions between quarks, so the strong force occurs on the nuclear scale. Quarks and gluons both very rarely exist independently and prefer to exist bound together inside hadrons or mesons. The weak force, which is modeled by quantum flavor dynamics, or QFD, or sometimes together with electromagnetism as electroweak theory, is mediated by the W and Z bosons. As mentioned previously, the prediction and observation of these bosons was a huge victory for the field of particle physics. One of the best examples of a weak force interaction is beta decay. Finally, the electromagnetic force, which is modeled by quantum electrodynamics, or QED, is mediated by the photon. The photon is known widely as the light particle, and light is composed of oscillating electric and magnetic fields that are orthogonal to one another and propagate through space. As a result, any interactions of photons and matter are governed by QED and electromagnetism. You may notice that we have one fundamental force left and one boson left. However, the remaining boson does not mediate the force of gravity. A quantum theory of gravity has not yet been formulated in a way that can be incorporated into the standard model. The best theory of gravity that exists today is Einstein's general relativity, which so far has been unable to be reconciled with the standard model. As a result, these two extremely well-corroborated theories remain separate. We will examine general relativity in greater depth after this investigation of particle physics. In fact, the final boson is also the most recently discovered particle in the standard model. The Higgs was proposed in 1964 by Peter Higgs as a field that filled the universe and gave mass to elementary particles. The Higgs boson would be the corresponding particle for this field, similar to the photon being the corresponding particle for an electromagnetic field. The strength of interaction between a particle and this field would dictate how much mass the particle ended up with, and the particle would gain this mass through something called the Higgs mechanism. This will be discussed in much more detail later, but in 2012, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN was able to produce and observe the Higgs boson using data from a large number of particle collisions. This particle's discovery confirmed that the Higgs field was real and added a key mass-generating boson to the standard model. Even though the standard model has been massively successful, there are limitations to what it can describe. As we mentioned earlier, gravity doesn't fit into the model in its current state. Additionally, its predictions about the mass of the neutrino were proven incorrect. Other failings of the model include its current inability to explain dark matter and dark energy. As we will see throughout this series, while the standard model isn't perfect, a truly impressive amount of information has been learned about these subatomic particles, as well as how they interact with each other and the world around them. But how do scientists study objects that are so small that they can't be seen even with the world's best microscope? The answer is simple. Particle accelerators, particle colliders, and a variety of ingenious detector technologies. similar to the Large Hadron Collider at CERN that smashes hadrons together, which once again are made up of three quarks apiece. There are particle accelerators around the world that excite and then direct beams of particles at each other so that they collide at extremely high energies and reveal fascinating physics. Because the energy scale of colliders reaches far beyond what we normally see in the universe today, these experiments can recreate the conditions of the hot and dense early universe, or in some of the most extreme parts of our universe today. This allows for a different angle of studying particles than just observing the ones present around us at this time. However, these conditions only exist for a tiny fraction of a second, so detectors must be phenomenally precise and fine-tuned. They operate kind of like telescopes, which are hit by photons that are manipulated into a visible image on your eye when you look through the eyepiece. These detectors turn energy deposits or charged paths from a variety of particles into electronic signals that can be read out as the signature of an event. Using a variety of computational techniques, the particles and their trajectories can be reconstructed to show all the details of the event that just took place. Using the powerful theoretical techniques of the Standard Model, alongside the sophisticated experimental techniques employed by particle physicists around the world, we've learned an incredible amount about the smallest building blocks of our universe. Throughout the process of learning about these particle constituents of our world, scientists have developed new revolutionary technologies, including computer chips, medical imaging and treatment, and the World Wide Web. As we progress through this series, we will learn about all the fascinating physics that governs Standard Model particles and the way that they interact. And we will also describe how much there still is to discover and learn about the field of particle physics.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.